I'm in St. Petersburg. That's a 5-foot wall behind me. It's the first wall you see when entering the bathroom. So you come in, and this is the wall that you see, 5 feet wide. Our product is a York non-matching pattern, glue, paste the wall first. Easiest job for a paper hanger. But if you mess up the planning, you blow it. Where do you put the seam? You start here. And then come within 3.5 inches of the end. You start in the middle. And then share this wall with this wall on the same piece. You know what I mean? If the middle is your first piece, your second piece is going to go beyond this wall and onto the next. Would you do that? Where would you start this job? Behind me? Well, if you said on this wall, you were right. I've never hung this, but in the case that the seams are to show, which I doubt, you want the first wall, the eyes contact, to have perfect symmetry. It complements the entire rest of the job. So you would hang the middle of this roll, because of the length of the wall, right in the middle of the wall. So the middle of the roll goes right over the middle. You see that mark right there? This way, when you walk in, just in case the seams show, even if they don't, it's still a perfect layout. That's where you want your seam. And that's every, especially grass cloth. If you Google or if you YouTube my name and grass cloth installation, you'll see a video I published within the last month of 2020, where it's perfect symmetry all around and the seams are obviously visible because it's grass cloth. Let's get the product up and see how we do.
Cutting around this light fixture. The homeowner tells you that the fixture literally goes right to the edge of the blue, not beyond. You have no room for error. How are you going to do it? You're going to make an impression on this thing. You're going to make an impression. I started trimming it inside of the circle by cutting those straight lines to take the tension off of this fixture foundation. Look at how much I'm sweating here. See that? You see, the problem with thick wall covering is you can't see the obstacle around which you're trying to cut. So you gotta try to make it visible by creating an impression on the wall covering so you know the boundary beyond which you cannot cut. This way, you don't wind up with a situation where your wallpaper's looking like this, away from that electric box. So we're just gonna do that and make an impression on the wallpaper, and then we'll trim it like that.
People get confused when it comes to cutting around pipes. Now, I don't even have to do this. There's going to be a vanity in there, and the boss said, you don't need to do this, but I like to bring it all the way down to the floor. The mistake would be to cut this in the wrong place because you judged the wrong area of penetration. You want to hang this out as straight as you can against the pipe. That's going to be where you want to make your penetration. Not doing this, that's going to mess you up. It's going to give you a false sense of where the penetration will land. So you want to bring it out, and I'm bringing it out. See above in your top screen? I'm bringing it toward me. I'm feeling for the pipe behind me. Just want to make a penetration just enough so I can get this thing through the paper. Okay, that was through. That will allow your pipes to come through like that. It takes a little more time, but you can do it. Now we guide it back, two hands. We don't want to tear. Okay. Nice and easy. Now, we don't have it up against the wall yet, but now we don't want it tearing anymore. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to start making stress relief point. Cuts. Okay. So that instead of continuing to want to tear the original cut, it'll start laying against that pipe. Same thing here. We want to go on the side of the pipe and press against it, lifting the paper up so as not to nick the PVC pipe. Same thing here. Okay. Now we can say, hey, this is a professional job because we've taken the time to cut that wall covering as little as possible. Would you agree? Okay. And so, we're going to put the rest of them. Oh, we have another thing, the drain pipe. Okay, so now look, I take my thumbs and I'm just pushing my paper. Why? Because I'm a perfectionist like you are. Anybody doing this is a perfectionist. You cannot do this unless you have a wacky desire to be perfect, which will never be. Never. Only Almighty God is perfect, right? I often laugh at how much we try to be perfect, and it never happens. You just never be perfect, but we try. Okay, so now you see what I'm doing. Putting it in place, laying it down, putting some friction against there so she stays in place. Let me take a look at it. What do you think? Can you tell it's been cut around pipes? No. And if you do this, you can do the same job. I don't care if you just started this. You can do this. So we made our cut again. Same thing like the pipe. We're just going to cut it around this thing by making impressions and cutting like this. In, in. Not this way. You don't have any reference. You want to feel your pipe and then cut. Feel it again, cut. Now that we have that in place, we're going to try to cut around this. Oh my gosh, how do we do that? Now this is an exaggerated challenge from what we just did here. Okay. Who would cut it here, right over this? Ah. Now, I'm gonna go against the rule that I set over here. This is where you wanna cut this. This is where the pipe starts. Okay, so you wanna take your pencil or make an impression. Okay, that's where you want your cut to be. All right, we're gonna make some marks on there. Impressions, I like to make impressions. Do I make impressions on you? Yeah, I sound like Mr. Rogers. Do you like the color red? Okay, let's do that. And we're gonna cut that from here, and then we're gonna have to go all the way down. And by putting your blade right up against the green smoother, you'll get a nice, even cut if you take your time, going nice and slow.
just like that.
By the way, just a note on cutting around this thing. The more slits you put in the interior part of the circle, the more stress you take off of the wall covering on the outside, which will permit it more easily to make this. See that impression? You see, the less stress you have of the wallpaper being together without being cut, the more it resists making the impression. The more you cut it, it relaxes and gives way to the impression. I can only make this impression because I've loosened up the tightness by cutting. Okay, just wanted to cover.
So as I'm doing it, you start to see teeth, right? And they're cut toward the pipe. I feel where the pipe is and I cut this way. And that's how you
do it. So that when you get all around that pipe,
you're perfect. Now I know this is a challenge. Trust me, I know. I remember doing it my first time last week. And, you know, I understand that this could be difficult for the person who's just trying to do it today. Okay?
How do you like that?
Come on, man. You know you love it.
Now, you remember how we cut that corner, right? I just had an idea regarding this corner. So, again, this is our first wall that we walk into and we see this. So the edge of this sheet, we don't want to see that edge by flapping it up onto this wall and then we're looking at this edge. This edge has to be tucked under that one. But here's what we got to do. After I just got this 13-inch wide strip straight, I have this corner is very crooked. I mean, look at the bottom of that. So I have to take a lot of it off. But I was just thinking, like this, I have to take this piece off. But in order to do that, I have to lift this sheet up. That becomes a problem. But I just had an idea for you to use in the future. If you took a corner bead, a metal corner bead, and inverted it, sticking the hard corner into the corner, and then put your wallpaper in there, you could simply cut up against the metal corner bead without having to move that. You wouldn't be cutting that. You know what I mean? Don't you think that's a good idea? You put the corner bead in backwards, or the way you would never use it, the way it would go into this corner here, and then your wallpaper would flap over the metal flap, and then it would come out onto the other metal side, and you would simply cut against the metal instead of having to take this flap off in there so that you don't cut it. If you cut this piece, it's not going to fit into the side, into the corner. I hope you understand what I'm talking about. Now, if you say, oh, I can't do that, it's only because you will not force yourself to take the time to do it. You have to go slowly when you're doing something like this. And then anybody can do this. Okay, so let's examine our work as we're a little more than two-thirds done. Now, do you see that? Now you'll say, that's the seam, right? Well, I want to show you, if this happens to you with this product, you make sure that your seams are as tight as can be. And after that, you've done your job. Now I paid particular attention not to run my smoother over the seams. You know, over time, when you do this a lot, you know what not to do to wall covering. But I'll tell you what, this stuff takes a beating. But I pay particular attention because it's so, you know, like any imperfections will show up on this. Look at that bubble right there. So I pay particular attention and I noticed that the pattern, remember I said to reverse the patterns, there's a slight shading and it has nothing to do with the seams. Again, you go close to the seams. If your seam is tight, well, guess what? That's, you've done your job. And listen, this one started to hairline on me. I went right over there. I just got a call from Ontario, Canada yesterday about seams. And I'm not taking any crap from seams. I went right over there, boom, I hit it right back. That's why you can't run after the job. You have to check your seams. Okay, again, look down that seam. Make sure that your paper is right up on top of each other. And if it's not, You see how? Look at that. Right? But it gives a lightness to it, doesn't it, right? At the seam, right? So what I'm trying to say is make sure that you do this throughout the job. You keep coming back, making sure your seams don't move, because once they split, oh my goodness, is it hard to get the wall cover back into place. So you have to do what I call nurse the seams. You come back and look over them. And as long as you can tell your customer, let's take a look closely. As long as my product is touching butt to butt, my work is perfect, you know. So you know what I'm trying to say. You make sure that your product is on top of each other, because you don't want to turn over a job to a customer and your seams are, you know, a hairline apart. It's such a mistake that could have been prevented. You just have to keep going back and working it. Take the palm, there's another trick. You just take the palm of your hand and ease the, you know, because it's all moving, you know, it's drying. And so as it dries, there's a displacement of liquid underneath it, right? When the glue evaporates, or the paste, I should say, evaporates, you have a displacement of volume underneath it. So you wouldn't be able to see with the naked human eye, but theoretically, at least anyway, right? If it's evaporating, something's disappearing, right? And that manifests a separation, a hairline separation in your seam. So you keep on top of them, anticipating that they'll separate. The only time you're not going to see them separate is with paper thin wallpaper. You know, the cheap stuff. That's not going to split on you. But I don't like hanging that stuff. Anyway, let's continue on. So I just went back over the seam and I just took my thumb. It's good that I'm missing the seam now. I can't see where it is. And I just nudged it together just like this. Working on it now, almost 2.5 hours after it's been installed, just pushing on it. And imperceptibly, I'm pushing the material together. I mean, you can't see anything there. But when you come a distance away, now it's wet, I wiped it down. But I'm making sure my seams do not split. And this is what I urge all of my viewers to do as well. Give it your best. Get up there, get back up on that ladder and make sure you've done your best that your seams don't show. Remember, the material moves. Now, this is one of the facts about why you have to be content in what you're doing. What do I mean by that? You want to know one of the greatest mistakes of craftsmen today? I'm going to tell it to you.
When I say craftsman, I mean a guy who lays tile, a carpenter who builds. You know what's their worst enemy, right? Time. Why is that? They're looking to get on to the next job. I came from New York, and contractors up in New York are going from one job to another. They love what they do, but they're not enjoying themselves. I'm going to tell you why. They're all rushing to get to the next job because money, money, money. And here's the reason why. They think if they charge more, they're not going to get the job. I'm going to give you a little business insight. You have to charge for what you do. If you do a job that's not so great, don't charge too much. You don't deserve it. But if you're doing this when you could be wrapping it up and going home, you need to charge for your time and for your effort. Okay? Now the next guy, he's $400 cheaper. You'll hear. The other guy wants $400 less. Oh yeah? You know, let me tell you something. That is the most ridiculous statement a customer can make. And it's the easiest to challenge. You have to say, oh my gosh, show me his work. Show me her work. I don't have any of that work. Well, how can you tell me what they're charging unless you're comparing the quality of my work to his or hers? What kind of illogic is that? Oh, the next guy wants 400 less. You can't tell the customer, well, I stay and I do this. They don't even understand that. All they understand is dollars and cents sometimes. It's true. Now, I'm going to tell you, for those of you who do this for a living, don't take customers like that. Stay home for a day or two. Until you get a circle of clients who are saying to each other, when they go to the beach, when they go to the community center, hey, get this guy Spencer. He's the best. He's not the cheapest, he's the best. Because this is what your customer deserves, right here. And the guy who charges 400 less, he's gotta get home. Because he's gotta wake up early to get to the next job. Because he forgot how to enjoy his work. He's not enjoying his work. And in fact, it's often the case that the guy who charges less isn't getting what he's worth because he's not doing his potential at the job. So he's charging less because he's rushing the job. And when the customer sees the difference between your product and theirs, over time, they're going to say, oh yeah, she did mine. Yeah, she's the best. Oh yeah, that other guy did mine and he, you know, the seams don't look as good. And then you'll see the difference is not only qualitative, but it's quantitative as well. The price differed. This is what you gotta give your customers. And you can charge accordingly. Because if you're giving this kind of effort, you deserve compensation. Whenever your GC tells you he primed the wall as you told him, make sure you hold him accountable. Do you see this dilemma I have right here? This is the general contractor's fault. I told him weeks ago to have the walls prepped with oil. I don't trust that people do what you ask them to do. And so sure enough, it's true. He said, oh yeah, it's primed with oil. Now, this peeling paint can pose a serious problem to this wallpaper. I just peeled it off. And as long as you have it down where there's no air under it, it'll stick to the wall with this paste. But if that should become activated and reliquefied, now you got paint on your wall covering, thanks to the general contractor.
So this will be our kill point, which usually goes above doorways, right? So we have our laser level. I'm going to try not to get in the way of the laser, but I don't think it's going to be possible. So this sheet is already laid down, and it comes under this sheet that you see that's already up. You see that? Up to about this line here. So I put it somewhere in the middle, and I'm just going to splice right through it and be done with this job. How do you like it so far? I mean, this product was so easy. I mean, really. And its perfection is attributed to the product, the quality of the product, the tie-in stuff. And I'll leave a link in the description of the video. This isn't cheap wallpaper. I like it a lot. I think it's stuff that you would see in a hotel. This is a high-end home. And so it's just smart looking. It's what I would call smart looking wallpaper. I really like it. It's not grass cloth, this is vinyl. Okay, let's get that cut done. I got it to work. But, you know, I'm being honest with you. I was lied to. I was told that as I requested, the whole job was prepped with oil. And the reason why is because if you should take a break or be delayed in your seam work, you'll lift off the substrate. Can't have that. Okay, so that worked out. We're down to the last of the job. For my piece over the doorway, I decided to do a double cut. And so I simply overlapped this piece over this one, gave myself a straight line, and cut according to the laser. So let me try to show you. My seam, that's the one I made. Show you where it is. And now to try to find it. Now, please don't take credit for seamless wallpaper. This appears to be seamless, right? You think I'm good. But it's not me. This is the wall covering. And that's what you want to tell people. There are wall coverings that simply hide the seams, and there are others that do not. I am not a magician. I hang the paper according to the industry standards, and the results are the results. Don't kill yourself over a seam showing when your seams are joined. If your seams are joined, there's nothing else you can do about it. This happens to be apparently seamless, but even when you join your seams, especially with black wallpaper, you might see a seam, and in that case you have to be artistic and put tape on each side and start coloring the visible white on the edge. It's actually the side of the wall covering that's not colored, and that's what is showing. But try to tell that to customers. You have to explain, show them the side, it's white. And there's various tricks to hide
them. So I was not able to move my body out of the way of the laser. So I just, you know, as you do this a lot, you know how to keep the blade pretty much straight, okay? So I cut through them both, okay? And here we are. Now, normally I don't recommend this much of an overlap, because what happens is you wind up pulling up this cheap paint that they put on here. This was a wallpaper removal job, so I was too busy. I told the general contractor, please remove the wallpaper yourself and prime it with oil, because you know and I know that oil arrests paste, right? And there you have it. I mean, look, this stuff is perfectionist wallpaper. And I'm telling you, anybody watching this video is interested somehow in wallpaper, you can do this. What I just did, you can do too. It's very simple. On my heart of jobs, I say, you know, don't try this if you're brand new at it, unless you buy extra wallpaper, because you go in and make mistakes. But there you go, let me show you the whole job.
To recap, we hung a York product today. Paste the wall, 27 and a half inches. And that's the pattern number, in case you're interested in this wall cover. Now let's take a look. So we enter the bathroom. And this was the first wall we gave attention to, for obvious reasons. It is the wall that you see when you enter. And we chose to place our middle sheet, the middle of the middle sheet, in the middle of the wall. And then we simply went around the room. If you're enjoying this pattern and its apparent seamlessness, please give proper credit to the manufacturer. I can say that it went up with great ease.